Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I think we have some diners that are strolling in. I see them down the hallway. Hope you had a great day, and tomorrow we'll have another great day. We will begin at 1300 or 1 p.m. here again. You guys keep loading up so quickly, we're going to put the servers to work serving you drinks. But you guys did a great job today. Thank you for being timely and orderly. One programming note for this evening. As you all know by now, we're starting a little bit late for this to make sure you all had enough time for dinner. And tonight will be even a little bit lengthier of a night, though probably not as long as Das Boot. That is because we're going to have Don, joined by his five fellow World War II veterans, come on stage after Dr. Mueller's presentation. Stand up now, Don. You're going to have to share the glory later. As I've said, we've wanted you all to... Oh, there's Ralph. You're hiding. You're supposed to be sitting in one of the chairs, Ralph. You're fine where you are. You're fine where you are. But we wanted to get these guys up here and let you know who they are and learn more about their service. And then after the veterans, we think 9:15-ish or 9:30-ish, at this point probably 9:30-ish, we will play the Dirty Dozen here in the show lounge. If you choose to retire back to your cabin to watch the film that's playing on Channel 15, I've made an executive decision to play a wartime film instead of a documentary. I thought that the audience that chooses not to watch Dirty Dozen might actually like watching a wartime film. Hail the Conquering Hero, starring Eddie Bracken. It's a 1944 film. It actually was up for an Academy Award for Best Original Screenplay. It's sort of a satire, but it's a good, fun show. It's more of a satire of hero worship, which is interesting because our founder is accused of hero worship. Dr. Mueller's best friend, Stephen Ambrose, but guess what? These guys are heroes and they should be worshipped. So even in 1944, Hollywood was poking fun at the military. But it's a fun, rollicking show, and you can tune in to Channel 15 for that. So I think we've had most everybody sit down, though I assume we'll be joined by some folks. But now it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Nick Mueller, the president and CEO of the museum, to give a talk on amphibious warfare. Thank you.
Tell me, wait. How do I work this thing here? This advances, and this is the pointer.
You got it.
All right, folks. How are everybody doing? Okay, after a long day? That's great. Well, you know, historians, when they speak at conferences, always go and wonder if there's going to be an audience. And we've had a long day, and so I was wondering about an audience, but we're pretty good here. One thing about this audience is it's you're captured. You know, you're here on the ship. You can't get away. But there's this occasion when one historian went to a conference, and he showed up for his 10 o'clock talk, and he was supposed to be there, and there was only one person in the front row. And he said, well, I'm here at 10. There was nobody to introduce him. So he said, well, I'm supposed to talk for 20 minutes, so I'm going to do my talk. And he did his talk, and the guy in the front row clapped. And then the guy said, thank you, and he started picking up his papers, and he was leaving. The guy said, well, now you can't leave. And he said, well, why not? He said, because I'm the other speaker. Well, we're doing a lot better than that tonight. Since you guys can't get off the boat, I figured that we're going to be all right. Well, in any event, let's get into it, and we're going to talk a little bit tonight. I'm trying to compress things a little bit, so if it seems a little discombobulated along the way, that's because we're trying to compress things a little bit. Might not feel like that, but we've got the veterans coming up afterwards to speak a few minutes about their experiences, and maybe just tell you one story about their experiences in World War II. And then you'll get to know them and know what theater they were in and what they did and be able to talk to them later. But in any event, we're off to a great start with our other speakers. Rob got us going with the German expansion and strategic weaknesses that the Germans had at the by 43, 44, and how they were, you know, outrunning their resources and their manpower. And then Rick got us going with the clash of systems and how the system's capacity and production superiority ultimately displayed and generated by the United States was the key to victory in a global total war. And then Don this morning talked about technology and that was applied, and the men inside the tubes, whether they're on the B-17s or in the Higgins, it's not the Higgins boats, I'm getting ahead of my story, in the submarines, and he got inside those planes and inside those submarines, and the attack on the submarine pens here, and how we finally defeated the U-boat menace. Tonight, I'm going to talk a little bit about, in a different kind of a flashback way, to some stories of innovation and leadership at a level, background level, that you're probably not expecting. I'm not going to get into the beach landings, but we're going to get set up for that and how they finally happened. And I'm going to focus on a single tactical weapon of the war that was decisive. Rick and others and Tom Brokaw are going to be talking about the actual landings later on, so remove that from my talk. If we go back just in the very broadest sense, before the war started, and Rob talked about what the planners knew and what they were planning for, and I'm going to say a little bit more about that, but in the broadest sense in 1940 or so, we already knew that if we were involved in a war, there were four or five strategic challenges that had to be overcome if we were going to survive and hopefully prevail. And that was, we had to get control of the seas. Don talked about how we did that in large part with U-boats. We had to get control of the air. We didn't have that either. We had to build a logistical arsenal, the arsenal of democracy, productivity, supplies, and overcome the vast distances across two huge oceans to get our men and supplies, and then finally getting our troops ashore. Getting our troops ashore, and that's what we're going to be focusing on today, because in a few days, this is where you're going to be. These are the guys going ashore, Omaha Beach. You can see the bluffs behind them. Freedom fighters going in the teeth of enemy fire. One of the most heavily fortified areas of Hitler's Atlantic Wall. These guys were going there to defend our freedom, our liberty, our way of life, and they were going ashore to defeat Nazi tyranny. And it was a dramatic, pivotal moment in the war. And so what I want to really focus on is, how did these guys get here? And I'm going to talk about a couple of guys, these two guys, bold, forceful visionaries, independent thinkers, devoted to their country, who played pivotal and critical roles in resolving one of the most enormous problems faced by America and its allies in World War II and leading up to it. They figured out, these two, who didn't know each other, came together in 1939 and 40 to figure out how to land troops and equipment quickly at heavily defended enemy beaches, and it was their work and their ideas that made the Normandy invasion possible. As much as any Americans, with the possible exception, of course, of President Roosevelt and General Eisenhower, they influenced the war's outcomes. These two men, a U.S. Marine officer, Victor Brute Krulak, right here, and the New Orleans boat builder, Andrew Jackson Higgins. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about their stories later, but I know the Marines who are here are going to be happy, and we'll get a hoorah from the Marines since they're not at D-Day, so let's hear it from the Marines right now. All right. So they're part of the story, and you're going to find out exactly how. Well, first of all, you know that in the broadest story, that D-Day, the Normandy invasion, is regarded as the pivot point of World War II, perhaps the pivot point of the 20th century, and one of the most important moments in Western history. And we're going to be on these fields and on these beaches in just a few days to commemorate the climactic battle of World War II, the day that changed history, changed America, and changed the world. And here these guys are. Now they're out of the boats, wading ashore. But I'm going to let some of these guys talk in their own words right now for about 5 minutes and let you hear from them rather than from me.
Yeah, we're never gonna Indian who's coming hell-bent for leather straight at that beach, and then he turned broadside. Boy, they pumped 5 rounds into that artillery emplacement there that the Germans had. After they pumped 5 rounds in there, that quieted them.
Just a short time after that, a man crawled up on my right side. He had a Bangalore in 2 sections, and he was putting it under the barbed wire. And it didn't go off. He crawled back up and removed that bat lighter, put a new one in it, pulled the string on it, started to back up. And at that second, he was hit, and his eyes looked directly at, into mine. His eyes as he died was a questioning look or a puzzling look. It's hard to describe. And then his eyes just closed. To me, that man was the greatest hero on that beach, because that Bangalore went off, and when it went off, I was up and through that wire.
That happened, then we start going back up the bluff and kept on going. We walked along a trail, and that was marked out by dead bodies, you know. Just stay to the left of these guys. And that's how we got up there. But that was something else.
Whoa. Well, it's hard to back away from that and to understand how these guys got there and how they were able to carry out their assignments on the beaches and what was at stake. So I'm going to flash back, because this was a huge moment for the Allies. And the war's outcome hung in the balance, and I would argue the fate of Western civilization depended on the success of that invasion. Some people you're familiar with, what they had to say about D-Day, Winston Churchill called it the most difficult and complicated operation ever to take place. Before the invasion, Adolf Hitler said, "The destruction of the enemy's landing is the sole decisive factor in the whole conduct of the war, and hence its final results." And later, Joseph Stalin said, "The history of war does not know of an undertaking comparable to it, for the breadth of conception, the grandeur of scale, and the mastery of execution." Well, here's where it all took place. This is setting the stage for the invasion that we're here on this cruise to explore and understand on the 70th anniversary. And I want to create a little background, a lot of background, about the importance of this invasion from the point of view of the ability to, our capability to execute it, the amphibious aspect, the amphibious challenge, the amphibious gamble, whatever you want to call it, it was huge. Up to this point, we had had a tough time in Tarawa with the Marines. North Africa, there were screw-ups everywhere. Sicily was a problem. Salerno, we almost got thrown off the beaches. Anzio was a screw-up. There was no invasion up to this point across an open beach that had been successful, and they were damn close run things. So even if you look back over all of history, amphibious invasions were always a huge gamble. Going back 2,500 years, when 5 million men came from Persia, the mighty Persian Empire, to try to defeat the tiny Greek city-states, an amphibious landing at Marathon in 490 BC failed. And they had huge, overwhelming odds against the Greeks. In 1066, the epic invasion of England going the other way across the channel by William the Conqueror succeeded. And then in World War I, the disastrous invasion at Gallipoli in 1915-16, when the British and the French and Australians failed in their amphibious invasion, failed to gain a toehold, and then had to abandon it. And this epic failure shaped the thinking of our planners and everyone's planners in the period between World War I and World War II. And just to show you an image of Gallipoli at that point. And all of these historic invasions were turning points for both the winners and the losers. So let me just say a few words about the amphibious challenge, because in the 20s and 30s, you have to realize that everyone believed that amphibious assaults against a well-defended front was doomed to failure. And the shadow of Gallipoli hung over everybody. But here's what it is. An amphibious assault on a defended position is one of the most complex military operations that you can imagine. You have to attack out of water. It's slow, it's cumbersome, it invites counterattacks. The ocean itself is the first obstacle. And you have to then supply out of water, which is more difficult. The logistics are challenging. You're terribly vulnerable. It's known as, to the Marines and others, as a hard landing, in which the attacking force will suffer heavy casualties. And after Gallipoli and in the interwar period, except for the US Marines, who refused to accept this conclusion, it went into decline. In 1920s, the famous preeminent British historian, Basil Little Hart, asserted that amphibious landings were almost impossible. And so during this period, the US Navy believed that if war came again to Europe, France was going to hold off the German Navy, and we'd still be able to sail into French ports the way we did like this one here in Saint-Nazaire, the way we did in World War I. And we'd offload our troops off of troop ships in the ports, and we'd march off to battle. And that's what the assumption was of most of the planners. And even as late as 39, the Army was still focusing on large-scale land campaigns, showing no real interest at all in amphibious warfare until 1940. Only the US Marines, after Gallipoli, were looking ways to figure out the mistakes and apply the lessons of that failure. But the big problem was there were no landing craft. So not only did this deep decline in the amphibious doctrine and a way to we would wage a war occur, but we actually had no landing craft anywhere. I mean, that's maybe not entirely true. I mean, there were 18 landing boats in the late 30s that we had. They were the same ones that were used in 1898 in the Spanish-American War when we invaded Cuba. That's what we had in the late 30s. That's it. So here we go to Ike. Here he's planning the largest invasion in the history of the world, the largest amphibious assault. So Operation Overlord is the overall operation, but Neptune is the amphibious assault. And 4 years before this photo was taken, there were no landing craft. The amphibious doctrine had been in decline. So what happened? So we have to look at some of the events that occurred that caused a revolution in the thinking of the military planners in the 30s. Now, Rob talked about you can't ever predict, and they always wrong about predicting what you're going to need in the next war, and this was true in the 30s. So war planning had focused on Japan and the Pacific until 38 and 39, when suddenly it looked like we're going to have a two-front war against both Germany and Japan. That looked like that might be possible. So war games had been assuming a naval war. And all that changed when Adolf Hitler, and you've heard that story, invaded Poland and Belgium and the Netherlands in 1940 and pushing the British off the European continent at Dunkirk. So in 1940, in November, Secretary of Navy Frank Knox, with the impetus and support of encouragement of Harold Stark, Chief of Naval Operations, recognized that the greatest danger to America would result if Hitler completed all of his conquests of Europe, including Great Britain, and without Great Britain in play, a large-scale invasion, just think about this, a large-scale invasion coming from the United States across the Pacific or trying to get onto the continent of Europe would have to leave from the coast of New Jersey. I mean, across 3,000 miles with the U-boats out there, no opportunity to surprise, to conceal the invasion, much less that you don't have any landing craft to put men over an open beach. So there's no chance of concealment, no chance of surprise, and so the whole strategic thinking of the United States war planners began to change. And at this moment, of course, Great Britain is fighting for her life in the Battle of Britain as the Nazis were trying to subdue that island. And at the same time after that, Hitler began fortifying thousands of miles of coastline, 3,000 miles, and all the ports, especially after the fall of France. So, as always, success depends on strategy and logistics and operations. But in 1940, the strategy and the logistics and the operations trainings would not, I repeat, not support an amphibious invasion of the European continent or the islands of the Pacific without landing craft in enormous numbers. We all know that D-Day on June 6, 44 succeeded. And in one of its most recent chroniclers, a great book if you haven't read it on Neptune, Craig Simmons says, it was the largest seaborne assault in human history involving 6,000 vessels and more than a million men, and it began the liberation of Europe. So how did it happen, given our situation in 1940? What's the backstory? And it's quite an amazing one. As most often happens, the solutions come from a few key people who are always the driving force of innovation and leadership. And in this case, two extraordinary individuals who I've already introduced to you, one a career Marine and another a civilian manufacturer whose lives would intersect and with their vision at the right moment and to the good fortune of America and the Allied war effort. Now, these were obscure figures who were unlikely heroes and not often talked about, except at the National World War II Museum in New Orleans, where we certainly talk about Andy Higgins and as well as Krulak. Victor Brute Krulak, U.S. Marine officer, and Andrew Jackson Higgins, a lumberman and New Orleans boat builder, and how these two men found their way to get our freedom fighters into the battle in the beaches of Normandy, and how the influence of the outcome of World War II is my story tonight. Let me first concentrate a little bit on Brute Krulak. There he is, arguably one of the most important officers in the history of the U.S. Marine Corps. But one might not have guessed it from its origins, and General Boomer can tell you a lot more about his later career because I'm sure he knows him. But Brute, as he came known, and I'll tell you about that. He was born in Denver in 1913 as the first and only son of Russian Jewish immigrants who came to America about 1890. And then he went off to school in Cheyenne, Wyoming, unlikely move. Kind of sketchy why he did that, but claimed Denver always as his hometown. Now he's a short little guy, about 5'4", 110 pounds. He was admitted to the Naval Academy in 29. Actually, he flunked his first entrance exam. And he went to a kind of prep program, and he took it again. And this time, he got 3.7 out of 4.0 possible score. And so he went from rags to riches. And he was admitted. He went to the academy. And he got his nickname, Brute, from one of the upperclassmen on his first day, and it stuck. And but this guy always was in sketchy situations in high school and on. And he escaped a near dismissal from the academy on several occasions. And one of his instructors told him once that he wasn't the material from which naval officers were made, and he should consider another career. But he did graduate and secured the chance to befriend someone that you all know a lot about, if you know some of military history, Lieutenant Colonel Holland Smith. And he became his patron and surrogate father in the Marine Corps and an ardent champion throughout his career. Krulak was described by his friends and in newspapers, actually, as a brainy guy, a magnetic leader. And his senior year, he was on the rowing team, and he was the coxswain. And the New York Times even singled him out as a coxswain who was full of aggressive energy, a young man with an iron voice. And by the time he graduated, this cocky little short guy had matured into a person with absolute self-confidence. I mean, bordering on arrogance, with a force of personality that made him comfortable leading men almost twice his age. Now, in his military studies, Brute became a disciple of, whoops, I'm going to hit a schedule here, Pete Ellis. He's not on the slide, but I'm going to get back to him. There he is. Who predicted after World War I that war was coming with Japan. And he published a report in 1920 that could have been the blueprint for the Allied landings, American landings, really, in the Pacific in World War II. 1920. And this guy really influenced Brute. And throughout the 20s and 30s, the Marines were always fighting for funds for the advancement of the amphibious doctrine when everybody had given up on it. And this was the only way, thought the Marines, that would preserve their mission, the first to fight. Well, now, Krulak again, 1937. He was assigned to San Diego, and he supervised some experiments with various landing craft there, and he was horrified. He saw Marines climbing over these poorly designed Navy landing craft with high gunnels, and they were dropping over into surf over their heads. And he was disgusted with the whole operation. And from that moment forward, he became fascinated with the most critical and decisive issue facing the Marine Corps, and that is, how do you move men from ship to shore? Moving men from ship to shore. Well, now, right after that experience, before he had any time to do anything about it, he was shipped off to Shanghai. And he was one of those so-called China Marines in April of 37 at the opening rounds of the Sino-Japanese War. And one day, Japan was launching an amphibious landing on China near Shanghai. And the young Lieutenant Krulak was invited by a Japanese naval attaché to join him to observe this amphibious landing of the Japanese. So they got on a tugboat. Now, Brute Krulak jumps on a tugboat, brings along a naval photographer, and he gets right in the middle of the invasion fleet, and he sees this. And this is Krulak's writing, landing boat type A. He sees the Japanese have got something better than the Marines had ever dreamed about. And he is right in the middle of this invasion with a photographer, taking notes furiously. And he noticed they had flat bows that jutted up like an inverted V and sterns that were pointed. And here's another picture of the, you can see it again here. He's even got dotted circles around it. This is his handwriting here about the, he took notes. He went and looked at these boats. They were upside down later after the landing. It was amazing to him. And they were powerful, seaworthy, stable. They carried vehicles. They could take personnel right onto the beach. The bows opened and formed ramps that dropped into the sand and let vehicles and troops move onto the beach quickly. Then they revved their engines, backed up, pivoted around, and went back out to the troop ship and get another load. Krulak saw this happening, and he said, "That's it. That's it. That's what we need." And he wrote up a 13-page report. I don't know if anybody wants to read it, but I got it right here. It says, Report on Japanese assault landing operation Shanghai area 1937 prepared by First Lieutenant Victor Krulak, Assistant R2, 4th Marines, reviewed by and so on. And he sent this off to Washington after taking all of these notes on this Operation the Yangtze Delta campaign. I mean, this was amazing. He was so excited, and he provided the speed of the ships, what their troop capacity was, sent them to the Navy office in Washington that was responsible for developing new vessels, giving his own recommendations. Surprise, surprise. He was going to tell the Navy exactly what they needed to do to improve it. And then nothing happened, and a couple years later, in 39, he's back, transferred back to Quantico. Well, guess what? First day back, just about, he gets permission to go up to Washington, and he wants to find out what they've done with his report. He was so excited about it, he thought everybody would just jump on it immediately. So he found a Navy officer up there in the section that was responsible for designing new ships, and he knew nothing about Krulak's report, and they searched around the offices for a couple of hours. Finally, they found something stuck in the back of the file cabinet, and there's a cover sheet on it, and said, this report, prepared by some nut out in China. The Navy officer pulled it out, showed it to Krulak, and laughed. He said, the guy who wrote this didn't know the bow of the boat from the stern. And Krulak told him, I'm the nut from China. I wrote it. The Japanese built it, and it has a bunt bow and a pointed stern, and he saw it in action. Anyway, from that moment onward, Krulak became the marine expert on craft design and the amphibious doctrine. He thought the Navy was totally useless, and he got the Marine Commandant to pressure the Navy to allow the Marine Corps to think about designing its own craft. So he proceeded then to write the Marine Corps Logistical Doctrine on Amphibious Warfare in 1939. Now, we're just a couple years from Pearl Harbor at this point. But he needed a boat builder. So enter Andrew Jackson Higgins here. Just go to this one. This is a shot of Higgins here in the middle with FDR and the governor of Louisiana, and at his prime. But I'm going to flash back to his youth a little bit so you know a little bit about him, too. He was born in Columbus, Nebraska in 1886, youngest of 10 kids. Now, this guy had an impressive father who was involved politically, was a friend of Grover Cleveland, enthusiastic Democrat. He named his son Andrew Jackson, with that Democratic heritage, moved to Omaha, and was, when his father moved to Omaha, Andrew was a young man still under 9, but he already showed off traits of being a determined, strong-willed young guy with mechanical ability and entrepreneurial skills, and just this guy, age of 9. Now, every young kid starts off making money cutting grass for other people. This kid, at the age of 9, started cutting grass, and before you could blink an eye, he had 17 mowers working for him. Then he had a newspaper route, and he turned that into a district, and netting him, at the age of 12, $100 net every month in 1898. And then he started buying wreck boats, and he wanted to go fast. He liked speed, and so he got into designing a bobsled and then an ice boat, and he was just obsessed with it. And he built an ice boat in the basement of his house and found out he couldn't get it out after he built it. And his mother went off for a weekend, and he knocked down the whole side of the house, hauled out the ice boat, and then got his friends to come over and repair the wall before his mom got back. Well, now so you can see he's entrepreneurial, but he showed very little interest in school, played hooky, got in fist fights, rowdy behavior, went off to prep school, finally got kicked out of prep school, and his teachers said to his mom, never let him come back here. Now, you see a little bit in common with Krulak here. It's kind of interesting. So, but he does go into the National Guard in 1900, and had his first instruction, amphibious training, and I'll skip over that, but he got into the logging industry, and then he went down to Mobile, where he because he liked boats and he liked forestry. And he started his own lumber business. He got into banking and he learned import-export. And he went to New Orleans and he worked for an import-export house there for a little while, went overseas, made a lot of contacts that would be very important to him later on. In 1916, at the age of 30, Andrew Jackson Higgins started his own company, A.J. Higgins Lumber and Export Company, and he was off to the races. Very handsome young guy, 5'11", blue eyes, wavy light brown hair, strong, rugged guy in appearance, youthful face, very impatient, explosive, talented salesman, great charisma, and his personality, like a lot of great leaders, brought out the best in all of his workers. They were intensely loyal to him, and those he hired in one area were like him. They liked to work hard, they drank hard, and they swore hard when they were angry. But unlike his co-workers, Higgins had the poise and the brains to figure out how to negotiate complex lumber transactions. So he began to expand, and he purchased worthless timberland in the swamps and bayous, thousands of acres of land for a penny an acre, because everybody thought the timber out there was worthless. There was no way to get it out. And this brings us to the story. So what's he do? He buys 50,000, leases 50,000 acres at a penny an acre, and the next thing you know, he's got the problem solved. He designs a boat, a Eureka boat, with a recessed propeller and a tunnel boat rising inward, and he learned enough naval architecture to solve the problems. And his business boomed for a while, actually, because he was hauling out of this impossible areas this valuable cypress timber using these boats. He was even leasing his boats now to the Corps of Engineers and to wealthy people, but his most innovative boat was this Eureka boat, the shallow draft design, which became the prototype of the landing craft of World War II. So he had earned a reputation of being something of a swashbuckling kind of pirate and a boat genius, and the word was getting out. He'd go to the Coast Guard and say, you know, the rum runners out there in the bayou's got faster boats than you do, so you give me some contracts and I'll build you a faster boat. So he built a faster boat for the Corps of Engineers and the Coast Guard, and then he'd go to the rum runners and say, they got a faster boat, I'll build you a faster boat. And this went back and forth, and this guy was really, really something. But anyway, in 36, 37 area, to ratchet forward of the story, that he approached the Navy for a contract for a landing craft to no avail, really. They thought, you got to be kidding. A boat builder from Louisiana? You know, we got Norfolk shipyards and up in Connecticut, and the Bureau of Ships was all hucked into the politics of all the Northeast boatyards. But Higgins saw war coming already, even before Hitler started moving. Anyway, Lieutenant Krulak heard about Higgins and his Eureka boats with his 10-foot, 10-inch draft and flat bottoms and this protective tunnel for the propeller that could go over all kinds of obstacles, and they could run at full speed right up riverbanks and over sandbars and obstacles of all kinds on the water. And he began to, from a distance, he didn't even know Higgins, but he began from a distance to support Higgins' tough fight to win contracts from the Navy and the Bureau of Ships. And finally, in 38, he won a first contract to build an experimental 30-foot landing craft, and Handley won the competition that the Navy held in Virginia Beach. The Navy so hated doing business with this Southerner from New Orleans that they even stole his designs and tried to give them to another shipbuilder. But of all people, Senator Truman at the time was in charge of the Oversight Committee. He caught the Bureau of Ships in the act and said, no, you got to have a fair fight here. That was the first time that they tried to short-circuit them. But they had to let Higgins in compete for the larger contract for the landing craft in 1939 competition. Now, there were two contenders here. There had to be kind of a so-called fair fight. The Navy had their own model, and then Higgins had his Eureka boat. But his boat was, he wanted to build a boat that was 6 feet longer than the specs. And now this is more detail than you want, but Truman interceded, and the White House even got into this because the Bureau of Ships was trying to politically influence the selection in favor of somebody else. And they said Higgins' boat is 6 feet bigger than the specs. Higgins built a bigger boat because it was a better boat that way and it could get more men out onto the beach. So in any event, they had this competition off of Virginia Beach, and the Eureka hit the beach, retracted, pivoted in the surf, went back out to sea, and far superior to the Navy boat, which nearly swamped. The Navy guys were bailing water out of the boat. They couldn't even get to shore, and they had to go back to harbor, and the Navy had no choice. So Higgins was now, for the first time, on his way to the first big contract in November 18, 1940. Now remember that date, November 18, 1940. That's a year before Pearl Harbor. The first contract for a landing craft before we're into World War II. He also got a bonus order for a faster PT boat, but the Marines wanted an even better boat. So in the spring of 41, as the war clouds are looming over Europe and the Pacific, Brute Krulak went down to New Orleans to tell Higgins exactly what the Marines needed. And he brought all his designs from Japan, from those landing craft, and he showed him, he said, can you design a boat with a drop-down bow? Higgins saw it immediately. He says, I can do it. And they became instant friends, and the rest is history. And the result is he created the LCVP, the Landing Craft Vehicle Personnel, with the famous drop-down ramp. And then shortly after that, while that was in process, the Navy called him up trying again to bump him out of the process. And they said, look, you know, we have another huge contract coming up. We need a landing craft that can land a tank. And can you have the blueprints? We're coming down in 3 days. If you can't show us the blueprints in 3 days, you haven't got the deal. Higgins says, you come down in 3 days, I'm not going to just give you the blueprints. I'm going to have a boat ready for you. They said, that's impossible. He said, you wait and see. You just come down. And fortunately, the Corps of Engineers had, somebody had a contract for kind of a tugboat about the configuration of what became the landing craft tank. And he reconfigured that. They worked 24 hours. He brought all his guys in. And by the time these guys came down from the Bureau of Ships, he had an LCT ready for them. So finally, the Krulak-Higgins collaboration to hit the jackpot. They got the landing craft tank. He had the drop-down bow in production, which could unload 36 combat-equipped Marines on the beach in 19 seconds. Now, this is 1941, 2 years ago. We were talking about boats that were used, 18 boats in the Spanish-American War in 1898. So there is now a massive contract. I mean, ultimately, he builds 12,000 of these landing craft, the LCVPs. And there's a massive contract. Higgins gambled his whole business on buying the Philippine mahogany crop because all of these boats are built out of mahogany. He saw the war was coming. Philippines were going to fall. He wouldn't have mahogany. If he hadn't gotten the contract, he'd have been out of business again. I mean, this is the way this guy was. It was a feast or famine. I'm going to roll the dice, and we're going to go for the whole thing. So, again, there's one more competition in January of 42 in Fort Story, Virginia, to witness the final competition. I mean, it was a disaster for the Navy. The boats were just pathetic, and the White House actually came down on the Navy for allowing politics to interfere with the national interest in a time of war. The White House and Truman Sill in the Senate gave their backing, and Higgins got the contract of his life. So by July of 43, Higgins, the innovator, had figured out how to build not only a landing craft with the drop-down bow that could put guys ashore quickly, it shattered every boat production record in history. He figured out how to build landing craft on an assembly line the way Henry Ford built cars. Nobody had done that before either. At the peak of the war, he was producing 700 of these boats a month. And Eisenhower delayed the landing several months in the spring of 44 so he could get more landing craft because they expanded the number of units and divisions going ashore at the last minute. He had 30,000 workers. white, black, handicapped men and women all working on assembly lines to build his boats, getting paid the same wages for the same job. If you're side by side with somebody in an office or on the assembly line, black or white, you got paid the same. It was in the Deep South in the 40s. It was remarkable. These boats provided the technological breakthrough that would make these amphibious landings possible. The most notable one, of course, being June 6, 44, but they'd already been deployed in the Mediterranean and in the island hopping invasions of the Pacific. Now, the enormity of the final plan, just to close here, Operation Neptune, that we're going to be looking at in detail in coming days. The naval and the landing phase of the Normandy invasion was staggering. Staggering. Over 150,000 troops would be transported to the landing beaches. To get them there, Ike provided nearly 7,000 vessels of all kinds. There were 1,200 warships, 1,500 other vessels, and at the tip of the spear would be 4,000 landing craft. This never could have happened, going in over an open beach, without the vision of Brute Krulak and the genius of this boat builder, Andy Higgins. Many years later, in 1968, President and former Supreme Commander Eisenhower met with Stephen Ambrose while he was editing, one of the associate editors on the Eisenhower papers. And he asked him if he knew Andy Higgins, because he saw that Steve was from New Orleans. And he said, no, sir. He died in the early 50s and never met him. He said, well, that's too bad, young man. Steve was about 27 at the time. He said, you missed meeting the man who won World War II. Well, Steve Ambrose almost fell off his chair. I mean, here he's talking to the president, the former Supreme Commander, and he saw the shock, and the look on Steve's face, and he said, no, I'm absolutely serious. He said, without those boats, he said, we would have had to attack heavily defended ports. We had tried that in Dieppe. We had gotten clobbered. They were heavily fortified. We couldn't do it the way we did in World War I. And he said, those boats made it possible. And he said, maybe we would have won the war in another couple of years. The Holocaust would have gone on longer. Hitler might have gotten the bomb. Who knows what would have happened? It's one of those what-if things. But those boats, he said, were decisive. Even Hitler called Andy Higgins the American Noah. Hitler could never produce anything comparable to use for an invasion of Great Britain. And I've already talked to you about the landings that already took place in other theaters. So in the end, it's fair to say that the Allied victory in the Pacific and the islands of the Pacific, the Mediterranean landings, and the pivotal D-Day assault in Normandy ultimately led to Allied triumph and can be credited in large measure. Of course, there were a huge fleet and there were the air story and the land story that followed. But they can be credited, I think, to in large measure to this obscure boat builder from New Orleans and a single junior Marine officer who had a vision, who were innovative. And that's how the guys got to Omaha Beach and Utah Beach. That's how they got there. Robert Coram, Brute's biographer, says, and I'll just close with this, it's no small irony that the bow ramp, a design Krulak stole from the Japanese, was the key design feature of the boat that would contribute so much to the defeat of the Japanese and to the Allies, the Axis, their Axis ally, Nazi Germany. So that's our story, folks, and thank you for listening. Yeah, and we're running late. We maybe have a question or two, but we want to get the veterans up here as quickly as possible. But General Boomer may want to comment about the amphibious assaults for sure. And I know we've got some Seabees in the crowd who want to know about the Seabees and how important they were, and they certainly were. But But meanwhile, Jeremy's going to get some chairs out here for our veterans, and they can start coming up. Pardon me, those are heavy. He's going to need some help. Stephen's going to help with that, too. And we got our vets. Are they all down here? Y'all can start coming up. Anybody have a question that they...
Well, we use the Higgins boats. How did the British get ashore?
The British got ashore, actually, with Higgins boats. Higgins got contracts with the Brits, and I think they called them LCAs, but they modified them. But he was sending them boats from his designs. They had their own, too, but they used his designs for a great many of their boats, sending them already, I think it was early 1940. We had contracts for the British to get boats over there.
Okay. Next question.
We got our veterans wanting to start to come up here. No, it's getting late, so here we go.
Nick, the apple doesn't fall very far from the tree. And I was too young to know the brute. But in the first Gulf War, his son
Chuck.
Worked for me as a brigadier.
Yep.
And we changed the plan at the last minute, and Chuck was head of one of my logistics forces. He was standing outside the tent, pacing up and down. He said, "What are you going to do? What are you going to do? Tell me. So I came out and I said, "Chuck, we're going to change the plan, and here's the plan." He went off, and he caused the movement of a tremendous, I don't know the tonnage, I don't know, an entire division moved, and all the tonnage that went with that. And Chuck ultimately went on to become the Commandant of the Marine Corps. So, yeah. As I said, the apple doesn't fall very far from
That's
the tree.
Right.
Thank you.
And Brute was ended up as Commandant as well. Got fired by LBJ for telling him he was screwing up in Vietnam, and political meddling, including LBJ, was causing. He didn't realize that he told the president that there were casualties and the screw ups were coming from the White House, and LBJ ushered him to the door. But right up to the end, Brute spoke his mind with candor and vigor, and damned the torpedoes and the consequences. That was that kind of guy.
Before we get started, Dr. Mueller, thank you very much for your presentation.
Okay. Turn that off. We've got Don Pullen, Ralph Crump, Clark Langrall, Dick Deschersois, Paul Hilliard, and Jack Appel up here. All great. I'm going to ask them each to start with just one story, 4 or 5 minutes, just talk about one story, one experience during their time in World War II. And then we'll pass it on to the next one. We'll just let them just hear from them. And since Ralph is right here next to me, a member of our board, as you all heard the other night, went with us on a cruise a number of years ago. Ralph was in the Merchant Marines and, of course, had a successful career in business after that. But let's hear about the Merchant Marines. Ralph, you're on.
Thank you.
You got the mic. Hold it close to your mouth because it's hard to hear back there.
Hey. Can you hear me all right? I really wanted to be a gunnery officer on the cargo ships. I'd been working in the shipyards on the West Coast, and I met some guys as a result of that work. And I got tired of being a civilian, so I went to the Navy office in Seattle and said, I want to be a gunnery officer on the cargo ships. He said, great, we need guys like you, Crump. If you can pass the physical and the mental, we'll sign you up. And I passed the physical by probably the skin of my teeth, and the mental is still a surprise to me. But I waited, and I got impatient. I had a good job in Seattle. I went down to the Navy office and asked the guy, what's the problem? And he said, well, Crump, we only have two places to teach gunnery on the West Coast. One's in Monterey, and one's way out in the Seattle, Puget Sound area. And we don't have enough billets to accommodate you, and four or five other guys are on the list. And I said, well, where am I on the list? He said, well, you ain't at the top. So I was pretty impatient, and I'd go up there every couple of days, and he was a pretty frank guy, and it turned out that my name wasn't moving up very fast. It wasn't moving at all, as a matter of fact. And he reminded me, he said, Crump, let me remind you that when you signed up, you agreed that if we couldn't provide you with your first choice, you had to take the second choice, and if something came up and we couldn't give you the second choice, you had to take a third choice. And I said, what's the third choice? And he said, probably the Navy Aviation. And I know enough about myself that I'm not careful. And the last thing I want to do is to be a Navy flyer. So I asked him what the second choice was, and he said, you're going to get it. And he said, as much as we need gunnery officers, we need engineers to run the cargo ships, and we need mates and captains likewise to run them. And so within now just a couple of days, I get a letter directing me to go to San Mateo preliminary training of 90 days, and I had been accepted to the Merchant Marine Academy on Long Island. But it was a hell of a long time before I got to Long Island, I can tell you.
And did you have some close calls out there in the convoys in the Merchant Marine that you were running with the convoys with the Germans?
Well, with regard to I guess one of the most exciting times and fearsome times, if you want to call it that, this was, we left out of Los Angeles on a Liberty ship. They weren't very famous at the time, but they had become famous. And I was now an engineering cadet. And never mind how I got there, but I'm now out in Alexandria, Egypt, and we're forming up a huge convoy of 100 ships. And tell you something interesting. Each of the 100 ships had 100 POWs from El Alamein. And so once the convoy was ready to move across the Atlantic, we all thought we were coming back to Philadelphia. In our particular case, we had several thousand tons of high explosives, and we all wondered what the hell we're going to do with high explosives back in Philadelphia. And so we, when the convoy was all put together, they started to move west. And 14 days between Alexandria and where the toe of Italy pinches down to Tunis, by then we had lost 33 of the 100 ships. Actually, we started with 99, and somehow there was no torpedo for our ship.
Great. Thank you. Well. How about somebody here from the European Theater, Don Pullen, the Army, 911th Aviation Engineering Battalion?
I'm going to tell you just a couple of little stories. I'm going to tell you about getting ready to go across the pond. We climbed on board the British ship in Plymouth, and we couldn't get out because it was full of other troopers. So they put us on a rigid exercise program. You had to jump off the side of the ship, full helmet and all, and it's 30 feet down. If you lost your helmet, you had to dive down until you retrieved it. I almost drowned. I had to go down three times to get mine. When we went across, the weather was rough, but it wasn't bad. But then we couldn't get in to disembark, and so we parked out in the middle there. And as we sat there, it became more and more deciding that we weren't even going to go in the following day. The next morning, and if this doesn't make you sick, nothing will. They gave us cold pork and hard-boiled eggs for breakfast. Every guy that ate got sick. The next day, it was even worse. They gave us two cold porks and two eggs. And we bailed over the side. Or I shouldn't say that. We pulled in and then bailed over the side and into the famous Higgins boat. And they took us in a short distance and they stopped. And we hollered to the guy that was in charge of the craft and we said, take us in, take us in. He said, this is as far as we go. We bailed out. I went over my head and I don't know how the rest of them felt, but I thought, this is it. I took about two steps and I was sticking up. And from there on in, while I went in, they had stopped at the sandbar and we had, when we went over the side, we fell down and went over our head, then we come up. And we pulled in on in there and we ended up, and as we got in there, they were pulling in a bunch of German prisoners, kids. And I have a picture of them. And one of the guys who went in with me looked at him and he says, we shouldn't be shooting those kids. He said, what we ought to do is beat the blazes out of them, he said, and send them home. We went on in and we hit a little clearing and there was, we went in as a part of a company. We didn't go in, it was a full one. And as we stopped, we heard a rifle shot and it wasn't ours. And so Delmar Mercer from Akron, Ohio and myself, we grabbed our weapons and we took off on a dead run out through this field and out in the direction of where the rifle shot came from. We found a little girl who had been shot, and it was, thank goodness, it just took out the back of her leg. I tied a TNT, and Daryl put a rag around it, and we hollered for the medics. And about 10 days later, somebody comes up through the area where we were parked, and it's this little girl, and she wants to know where those two guys were that picked her up. She had made Dell and I. Three little hankies made out of parachute silk. And she gave them to Dell and she gave them to me. I got mine mounted on the wall at home. And I said to Maddie, she's here tonight, and I said to her, Maddie, we got to see if we can't find that little girl because by now she's grown up, but I'd like to see her. As the day progressed, Dell and another boy from Salt Lake at that time was Bill McIntosh. We said, what is that? Rotten smell. That's in English. In GI language, it wasn't that way. And we started investigating it, and there was a Kraut, another one. There was a German dead one in the hedgerow, and he was ripe. So I said, I'll go in and tie the rope around him, and you two pull him out. So I climbed through there and I tied the rope around his arm. Tied the rope around his arm and Dell and Bill pulled on him, pulled his arm off. I had to go back in, we tied it around his waist, pulled him out. We called the medics and the medics come over and they took off his dog tag, and ID'd him a little bit. We dug a hole and dropped him in and covered him up. And that started our program of, let's start killing the Germans. One of the guys came up to us, and he's got a sign in his hand, and he said, "Did you guys see where you went?" We said, "No. All we did is went through the field." "Well, take a look," he said. And right there on the fence post was a great big sign about 3 foot long, and it says, "Achtung, mines." Dale and I had crossed that entire field one way, crossed it back coming the other way, and never touched a mine.
Wow. Okay.
I tell you, we lucked out. And then when we went into St. Marie Iglesias, those people were so overjoyed, they didn't know what to do. They were crawling all over themselves and crying and loving us. And if we were sober when we went in, we weren't sober when we come out.
Thank you, Doc. Thank you very much. And what about the man right next to you, Jack Appel? Jack, why don't you say a few words? Thank you, Don.
It's a tough act to follow. My name is Jack Appel, and I'm an alcoholic. Uh-oh, I think I'm in the wrong place.
Nobody else is standing up.
But let me start over. My name is Jack Appel. I served in the United States Army with the 17th Signal Operation Battalion, and we were attached to the 1st U.S. Army. Our unit was split up into three companies. A company went into Omaha Beach on the fourth day. Several of our men were on the Augusta doing signal work. The Augusta was a battleship. I was in Company B, and we were lucky enough to have to stay back in England in case the invasion failed to maintain communications. On D-Day 4, we had the radio trucks land in Omaha, and when I got there, it was D-28. I had a Jeep and a trailer. It was waterproofed, and we were, I guess, on a landing craft for tanks, because the ramps were wide enough for the tract of a tank, but small enough you had to be on the direct inside for a Jeep to come down. Well, I was the first vehicle on the landing craft, and behind me were all the trucks and tanks and whatever. And my Jeep was waterproof. We spent about 2 weeks waterproofing Jeeps. And we had the exhaust pipe up on the windshield. And I started my engine and went down. And one guy told me to go this way, and another one this way. And would you know it, my wheel went off the ramp, and the whole invasion behind me was held up. Anyway, six or 10 men came over, lifted my vehicle back onto the track, and I proceeded down into the water, sitting on the back of the chair, of the seat, and I got to the beach successfully without stalling, and there I met the motor sergeant, who hated me, and he said, "Turn in your Jeep, you're through." I wish I was, but I wasn't. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's shift back over to the Pacific a little bit, get Paul Hilliard, another one of our trustees. Paul, U.S. Marine Corps, real tail gunner of the Dauntless Dive Bomber. Paul, it's up to you.
I wasn't a tail gunner, I was a radioman gunner.
Radioman gunner, that's right.
I was
right.
A sergeant, but I had an officer as a chauffeur on every flight. I want you to know that. But I think I'm in the minority here, as usual. It's And it occurs to me that this program is the only thing between me and my pajamas, am I right? So don't delay, okay? No standing ovations, anything like that. So it, I was 17-year-old and I went to the Marine Corps in February 1943 and finished boot camp and the rifle range and so on. And then I went from being some kind of a worm to being what they called a Marine. And a platoon sergeant came in one day and said, tomorrow you're going to take an aviation radio radar aptitude test. And I said, oh, I don't know anything about radio. We didn't even have a radio, and I didn't know what radar was. And he looked at me like I was deaf, and he said, tomorrow you're going to take an aviation radio and radar aptitude test. So I took it, and they never told me if I passed. They never told me what my score was. But about 2 days later, I had orders to Jacksonville, Florida, aviation radio and radar school. So I took a 5-day train ride. It was real, not exactly the Orient Express, but Jacksonville, Florida for almost several months. Radio radar school and gunnery school and operational training and patrol bombers, and we fired at targets out over the Atlantic and so on, and back to San Diego and overseas. And they we went to Solomon's first, Munda, and then Bougainville. You know, not exactly vacation sites, but anyway, they we did hours and hours and hours of recognition, aviation and ship recognition, in a dark room with the flashes, these profiles on the screen, and teach you recognize it a 50th of a second or whatever. Was the difference between a Jap aircraft and a ship and so on. But anyway, then we drew, a short straw, and they sent us to the Philippines to fly close support for MacArthur, famous master of warfare. And but my most memorable adventure was on Bougainville. They put us aboard an old Australian cattle ship, and they assigned us a berth, if you call it that, below deck. So we went down there, and it smelled just like a cattle ship. So we parked our gear. We slept every night on deck, and we went from Bougainville to we anchored off Hollandia and the North Shore of New Guinea. And some screw up, and then back to Milne Bay in the East Fork. We spent Christmas of 44 in abandoned Forward Field Hospital, and then from there to Ulithia Stage with the convoy for the invasion of Ligai and Luzon, and we landed at Luzon in early January, and they put us in the back seat of SPD Dauntless dive bombers to fly close support and for sort of airborne artillery. But of all the missions I flew, nothing sticks in my mind like that Australian cattle ship. It's we in the South China Sea. We were in a convoy. Ships as far as you could see, and you couldn't see very far, but we encountered the tail end of one of those South China Sea typhoons, and I was a farm boy from Wisconsin, and I wasn't particularly happy aboard ship, although I did get seasick, which made me, as usual, a minority. And but that's the first time I can still see it. The propellers of some of those transports coming out of the water, and you could see the props. You could see the propellers turning, and then they'd dive, and the bow would disappear. And pretty soon the bow would reappear, and the stern would here. So, but that was, I thought, a great ride. But so anyway, in the Philippines, we did our mission, and we bombed wherever they told us. I didn't like the ride. I didn't like the, 12,000 feet in an open cockpit. It was hot on the ground, cold in the air, and I didn't like being cold. I'm from Wisconsin. I mean, the Yankees like being cold. I don't like being cold. But anyway, the dive took about 20-25 seconds, and I didn't mind that at all because you got warm. And then we ride back to the back to the base, and meant food and drink and so on, bathroom relief, which was wonderful. And then from when Manila and Luzon was secured, they took us down to Mindanao, and we flew out of Zamboanga. And shortly before the war ended, they put us on an aircraft and flew us to Guam, with a staging base for the invasion of Japan. They said, send you home for reassignment. And while I was on the train between San Diego and Chicago on leave, they dropped the first A-bomb. The night I got home, they dropped the second one, and a week later, the Japs said, that's enough. And the next morning, I woke up on the lawn of my mother's house, and like everybody else in Kenosha, Wisconsin, I had celebrated too much. So that's it. The end of the story. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Paul. Let's switch back over to the European theater, and Dick Duchessois, who's a new member of our Board of Trustees, served with the Army. Dick, why don't you tell us a little bit about your story?
Well, I would like to sort of skip the war stories and tell you a little bit about what I learned. I was very fortunate in going into the service at an early age. I'd been to military academy, and we had a certificate of eligibility. Some of us did that when we became 21, we would get a second lieutenant's commission in the Army. Right after the war broke out, they dropped it to 18, and I just turned 19. Oh, within 60 days, I was back in I was in the Army. I was very fortunate in that I was assigned to a group of a new branch of the service called tank destroyers. Nobody really knew what tank destroyers were. Other were supposed to be mobile assault guns, but you could call them what you wanted. But I also fell into another privilege when I went down to camp to be part of the tank destroyer unit. We had a bunch of draftees. Having been in military academy, I knew my right foot from my left foot after 4 years of being yelled at. So I was assigned a company to train the recruits. I had the privilege of taking those recruits and training them with the guidance of the battalion. But we each had to train our own units to a great extent. I took them through 5 campaigns in Europe, and we got through pretty good because most of our guys really came back as real heroes and real guys that were going. But we really didn't know what we were fighting for. We kept hearing about freedom, and of course we had to orient our people about talking about freedom. We talked freedom and freedom and freedom, but I didn't really know what I was talking about until after the war. When you're in special troops, particularly our type of troop, you're assigned to a division, or you're assigned to a regiment, or you're assigned to something that you really don't command, and they don't know what you can do and what you don't do. All that they really know is you're sort of an assault type outfit. So after the war, when the other divisions were going home with far less points than we ever dreamt of having, well, we were assigned to different things until the military government troops came over from the States. I went down to a little place, called a Kreis in Germany. A Kreis, for those that aren't familiar with it, and I didn't have any idea what it was, it's bigger than a county, but it's not as big as a state. We just had a handful, I think I had 3 officers with me, and then maybe 7 or 8 enlisted men. We're the Kreisleiter, you're the mayor, you're the governor, you're the jailkeeper, you're the judge, you're the jury. And I started asking myself, well, what is this all about? We've been talking freedom. We've been talking winning a war. And we've paid a very, very high price to do it. I used to have on Tuesdays and Thursdays a session in the courthouse, or what we called the courthouse, where the people would come in, that is the German people, to get their permits. I had no idea in the world that they had to have a permit for almost everything. One day, a farmer and his wife came in. She was crying. She wanted a permit. They wanted a permit to move over to another Christ or take some food over to their children that was in this other Christ. I said, well, there's no problem with that. I signed the thing. She said, but there's something else we have to ask you. We have a pig. We want to kill our pig because our children are hungry. And there's others over there that are hungry. Oh, I never had to get permission to kill a pig, so I signed that. She handed it back to me, and she was crying. She said, I can't take this. And I asked her why. She spoke better English than I did. She said, you haven't put on here who we have to share this with. All of a sudden, the lights came on. It dawned on me. Is this freedom? Is this the type of freedom that we want to have for our country? Normandy was the world changer. If the Germans had not let us on, or we shouldn't, let me put it another way, if we hadn't been so strong, they pushed the Germans back in Normandy, I probably today, and maybe some of you might be asking, can you get permission to kill your pig?
Dick is, and you all get to know him more and can talk with him more on the trip, but Dick will be receiving a Legion of Honor Award from the French government on the 4th of June. In front of all of you for his action under Patton in that tank destroyer unit that he, I didn't want to tell you much about, but he was wounded and almost left for dead there. So. Great new friend and wonderful stories of his experience in World War II, and that's one of the best I've heard, Dick. We'll come back and end, I think, the way we began with Clark Langrell and Merchant Marine story from Clark, and you'll close it out, Clark.
Well, I haven't participated in many things like this, but I have to say that I feel really humbled and really grateful for the service of these fellows. I feel that I played such a minor role in World War II. 1942 and 1943, as the historians have reminded us, was like a shooting gallery for ships that are trying to supply England and to build up for the war effort in Europe. And Telfair Knight, who was the maritime administrator for the War Shipping Administration, had a desperate job of trying to find people who could man the ships that could take these supplies overseas. And in 1942 and 1943, it was really a traumatic time because it was like a shooting gallery. Hundreds of ships were being sunk, and they were being sunk faster than new ones could be built, particularly along the East Coast. The ships would be sailing within sight of land, and the lights from Atlantic City and the other resorts would create a silhouette, and it was so easy for those submarines that came from those pens we saw today just to target them easily and sink them. So the U.S. Merchant Marine Academy was recruiting people to become officers to man these ships. And they had started the program, which would normally be a four-year program, where you'd come and it'd be a plebe year, where you'd learn the basics, and then send you to sea for a year to learn the practical things of what partially you did learn and what you're in the future to learn. But during the war, that was shortened, and it was 90 days, as Ralph told you, for the first spell, and then they'd send you to sea for 6 months minimum, and if your ship didn't come back in 6 months, that was it. But if it was less than 6 months, you'd go back out again. In both Ralph's case and mine, we spent the full year of 1944 at sea, in convoys, carrying supplies to the troops in the enemy action, and also supplying the Allies. My first trip to Europe, to the Mediterranean, was January 1943. And we were in a convoy of close to 200 vessels. And it was quite an amazing thing for a young fellow who was too dumb to know it was tough to be part of that huge, huge armada. We passed through the Atlantic Ocean with no consequence from U-boats. But now I've learned historically what's happened was between really good intelligence and observation from aircraft and escort vessels, together with the Enigma program where they learn how to break the German code, the U-boat sinkings were become fewer and fewer. So that was quite a relief to learn later, but we didn't know at the time. The second night past Gibraltar, and I learned this from colleagues, Ralph and others who've been in other convoys, the second night in was always really the most dangerous. Because the German spies would sit up on the hills in Spain and they would notify Berlin of how many ships and where they were and so on. And by the second night in, the aircraft would come over. And out of curiosity, just not long, a few years ago, I went to the archives in College Park, Maryland, and researched the convoy that I was in and Ralph's ship was by coincidence in. And learned that in that raid on the second night, they counted an estimated 50 Ju-88 aircraft pursuing our convoy. The ship that I was on had been loaded in Baltimore, Maryland, the Hawkins Point ammunition depot. And when I got aboard, it was day before sailing, and I didn't know how long that ship had been there. And so we left, and when we got to sea, which nobody ever knew where you're going until you left port, we were told that we were going to Suez, south port in Suez Canal, Port Tufik, to unload our cargo. And so off we went through the Mediterranean, and traditionally you always had another raid when you got to Malta, but beyond there into the canal. So we got to the canal, we're unloading the cargo before that. I want to tell you that the captain said that he had about, as I can recall, 12 to 14 columns in this convoy. And we were about a leader in column six or seven. And the captain said that as we were traveling on that second night, that we're to keep the nose of our ship a little back behind the other leading ships. But he had no reason to know why that was so, or never did share it with us at least. And I later learned that the strategy of the aircraft, the German aircraft, when they'd attack a convoy, they'd come to the corners and they'd drop their torpedoes and going through the whole batch of this huge number of ships, the luck of hitting one would be pretty good. And so the column leaders in the center were really less exposed, so that was really quite a blessing. When we got to Suez and unloading the cargo, the ship capacity for tonnage was 10,000 tons, and we had 10,000 tons of TNT.
Oh, geez.
So it was quite fortunate, and I later learned the reason they did that is because they figured if one ship goes, it goes. And if you had the TNT spread among many ships, far many more would go. So that was sort of one of the first really good luck things that I could, not first in life, but a major one in life. And as a result of that, I've sort of, I don't know why, just been very lucky in life, lucky to meet the terrific people like you, these heroes that I'm sitting with, and probably above all, not to minimize the nature of my appreciation for you folks, but for Ralph, because we were classmates at Kings Point, and by coincidence in that convoy that I described, Ralph, unbeknownst to me, was also in that convoy. So there's been a lot of interesting and lucky things in my life that, as I say, at the time I was too dumb to know it was tough, but looking back on it, there were years that were difficult, yet I really appreciate.
Thank you very much. Let me just say in closing that I think all of you feel you just played a small role, and whether it was in the Merchant Marine or in combat or on the home front, that's the way all Americans felt about World War II, and it was a great American spirit that came together that helped us to prevail and to go from a nation that was totally unprepared for war and what was ahead of us to a nation that ultimately prevailed and became the richest and freest nation in the world. And we think it's modest guys like you all and all of your spouses and friends and family on the home front that made the difference between victory and defeat. So we're very proud to have you all. Thank you very, very much, and we're adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you all, gentlemen. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. The good news for the night before you all leave, as we reapproach the West, we are going to the UK, which means we are going back an hour tonight. So really, it's only 9:00. Thank you all. I hope you enjoyed the evening as much as I did. Good night. We'll see you back here at 1 p.m. tomorrow.